Nee, laten we lekker beginnen.
Okay, people, please give it up for Brenno de Winter.
Yeah. Good evening. I would like to talk about why we have shitty software, but before I begin, I need some help creating software. Next year will be MCH again, and I'll be the harbor master again. But if you look at ships, they still have old-fashioned computer systems. AIS, the transponder systems, they're old-fashioned and poorly designed. And over the top expensive, we've got HackRF, we've got Raspberry Pis. So I'm starting up an open source project to create our own board computer. And if people don't have VHF radio, that we give them 27MC, because it's just as simple. So I need some help with that. The project is called Ben Hero, after my cat, the one with the dark hair. And of course, I'm here in Dutch. Then I can start with my talk. And there is this Dutch saying that what you don't know can't hurt you or doesn't hurt you. What I would like to say, and I'll explain the cats at a later stage during the talk, they're very important. The one on the right-hand side is my chief information security officer. And the one on the left-hand side is my data protection officer. Because if you work at companies that have people that don't know what they're talking about, can I at least have cats, you know, to advise me? But it's a Dutch saying to say, what you don't know doesn't hurt you. Why should we care? And that attitude, actually, I think is very dangerous. That's basically the premise of my talk. So I would like to take a look at our own IT industry, and I'm having a couple of notes because there are a lot of details that I want to share. And I want to start off by saying that in January I went on summer holiday to Tenerife with my wife, and we were on Air Europa because they've got this great 787 flying to Madrid. It's huge, it's perfect. The only downside was that the meters gave different readings to the computer than the factuals. So the pilot told us we have to restart the computer. And they did. 9 times. And we left 2 hours late. My wife said, thank God they take safety so seriously. I haven't really said that much during that flight. It gave me back a memory I had a couple of years before that on a Delta Airlines flight. We were waiting for departure, and we were then rolling up to the runway, and the pilot said that the onboard systems told him that there was a faulty flap, what you really need for landing and stuff. So we went back and they replaced the board computer. We rolled up to the runway again, and the computer said there's a faulty flap. So they went back again and replaced the board computer. And at that point, I realized, you know, sometimes binary information might actually be right. So I decided to get off that plane to see in the news the next morning that the plane did leave and on takeoff lost a flap. Keep this in mind for the rest of the talk, because it's kind of important. Let's go to a different industry, our industry, the ICT industry. And I'll take you back to the year 2011, when DigiNota was hacked. And some of you will remember the certificate that was rogueily issued, starwildcard.google.com. Handed out by DigiNota. It was one of the first incidents ever being investigated by a transportation and safety board. And basically, it said the boardroom has no knowledge of IT, and they have got no feeling how seriously an incident can be. For those who were involved in the incident, one way or another, it was very clear. You know, if you can issue one rogue certificate, How many orders could you have issued? A dozen? Million? Basically, it undermines everything we do. What does it mean? I mean, who's using it? It turned out that Iran was using the rogue certificate to spy on their own people or on a part of their own people. It's so that is what we learned. A month later, I organized Leaktober as a lesson because there was a hearing in parliament. You saw my picture there. There was a hearing in parliament where I said there's a structure that we basically do not recognize of bad software, bad procedures, bad dealing with IT. And most members of parliament thought that was bullshit. So why not just show it to them? So I invited people to basically show data leaks that have a consequence on privacy. And the results were enormous. There were 600 and so many reports of leaks in only 1 month. So it helped. Well, so at least we thought at that point. Until we had a couple of other incidents. For instance, a data breach at KPN, where the password turned out to be girl power, where it for DigiNota had been prod admin for production administrator. At, for instance, a hospital, the Groene Hart Ziekenhuis, where the password was green 2000. So you have a vague idea when they last changed the password. But of course, more recently with WannaCry, one of the many other incidents where we have seen, of course, poor software management. You know, all the incidents had non-patch systems and very, very, very poor segmentation of networks. So looking back at all these incidents, we keep making the same mistakes over and over again. This is one of the images made by Kaspersky back in the days for NotPetya. And this was, I believe, 5 minutes after the initial breakout in the Ukraine. Every country that is marked red is basically a country where they had an infection 5 minutes later. Something tells me segmentation is still an issue. Now let's go back to other industries and see how they were doing. And some of them know this is a big thing for me because boats are important to me. But if you look back in history, before we had steam engines, basically the reason why a ship would succumb was generally a storm. A huge number of people would die. And ships would break, that type of stuff. And over again, we figured out that, you know, we crashed for the same reasons. Then we got steamboats. We started to move a little bit faster. And with steamboats, all of a sudden, we discovered we had new incidents. The speeds are higher. And for instance, when entering a port, we had no clue where to put our ship. On the left-hand side, on the right-hand side. Of course, nowadays we know port side and starboard, but back then we didn't. So there were many incidents. And we kept making the same mistakes over and over again until the Dutch and some other countries said, like, you know, let's seize this. Let's have some basic traffic rules. For instance, when we, you know, at a smaller segment, we go starboard. We in the Netherlands have the Rhine, and the Rhine moves into Germany up to all the way to Switzerland. And at some points, it's really a tight crossing. So if you go on the right-hand side, starboard, then basically everything goes fine. We try to export that knowledge. We try to go international, and we failed. Basically, we failed because we had this company called the White Star Lines that basically said, like, oh, but these type of rules, we don't need it. We don't need uniform rules because that would really corrupt the level playing field. And we didn't. But, and this was, by the way, the Brits. I don't want to say anything about the Brits who said, like, we are against it, but it's just a fact and it's important for the example I'm just going to make. Then at a certain point, we started to build ships that couldn't break anymore. So you can go into storms, there's not really an issue. And there was this one interview in the New York Times, and some of you might remember this person by any chance, Captain Smith. He later would turn out to sail both with the name Titanic. But let's just go, and basically what he says is, you know, technology has evolved so far, it can't break anymore. Just as we say when we make a new software product. Well, the story is quite well known. There was just this tiny little error. As soon as you hit an iceberg, it turns out ice is cold. Metal will shrink, the ship will be flooded with water, and ultimately break, even though it's an unbreakable ship. Well, that's not quite true. We have the opinion the ship broke. The official report still says the ship sank as a whole. And that's for a very simple reason. All the people, the hundreds of people who were around the ship, we basically decided to say to them, you know, you're a little bit confused. You think you saw it break, but that's impossible. We've decided it's impossible, so it can't be. And of course we did, after the incident, learn a couple of things. One of the things is we need to have rescue means for everybody. So everybody has a life vest, everybody can get to a boat, everybody basically has a fair chance of surviving. When we communicate, that was really an issue with the Titanic, we speak one uniform language. There was a big misunderstanding because there was a difference between the US and the UK. The one would use Save Our Souls, SOS, and the other one would use Mayday. So they didn't really appreciate the full value when somebody calls for help. And if you have a radio, you have to listen to it. Basic things we know because we had an incident and we decided to learn from it. And one very important thing, if we know that icebergs might be an issue, we try and locate them and put them on a map. And we still do every day. We got this treaty called Safety of Life at Sea. Now, looking back from a risk management perspective, we say the Titanic is a black swan. It's such a unique incident that back then we couldn't foresee that something would go awry so badly. And in the IT industry, we claim the same. One of the fun things is right now in Amsterdam, for instance, the city of Amsterdam, they've got Windows 7, and they didn't get to, you know, change that to Windows 10. Why do they have Windows 7? Because back in the days, when Windows XP was already out of service, they weren't in time to upgrade. And why did they use Windows XP? Because when they were phasing out Windows 95, they weren't in time. We keep making the same mistake over and over again. And then we had Citrix recently, and we decided to turn off systems in the Netherlands. We made a big thing out of that. The fun of it is, if you turn a Citrix system down, basically your remote access is gone. And that brought me back to the story I told you a little bit earlier about DigiNota. When we turned that off, we all of a sudden realized, okay, there was no plan B for certificates. It's not that hard to fix that, but we didn't. And it turned out we didn't have a plan B for Citrix. So we had a new Dutch word, a Citrix traffic jam. We keep making the same mistakes over and over again. And then you can say, okay, but we can do risk management. We're not really that good at that. And last year I gave a whole talk about the Kaspersky case, so I won't repeat it. But basically, the whole story was, we don't trust them because we dislike the name. We don't know how to prove it. We don't know how to disprove it. So we don't know what we're talking about, so let's stop using it. Long story short, that's basically what happened. So we're not really good at that. Let's bring this knowledge to other industries. I told you, I went on holiday to Tenerife. And the worst accident in air traffic ever was at Tenerife. Basically, long story short, that's what I keep repeating, but my time has been cut short a little bit. Long story short, a KLM flight took off when it shouldn't have taken off. Miscommunication everywhere. And at the end, it crashed into a Pan Am flight, and I believe 534 or 84 people died. Very serious accident. Terrible. Bad communication, bad procedures, and a lot of things because of that accident changed, but still, at least that's what I thought. A lot of things changed. Last summer, I was in Lithuania. And what they did, I went on one of those balloon flights, and at a certain point, the pilot decided to go up. And I was really sure there was not a balloon above us. So I told him, and he went like, well, let's ask. And he started to talk in Lithuanian, and he waited for a couple of seconds, and he went like, nope, no answer, nothing wrong. Thank God, by then, the other balloon was a little bit faster, so I could point to him, and what's that? And later on, it turned out his radio was off. Bad communications. But what made it really interesting, that at a certain point, I heard English language. So I went like, what's that? Oh, that's the airport. So you talk Lithuanian among each other, yes. What if there is a plane somewhere around here? Oh, they're not permitted here. Bad procedures. We're keeping making the same mistakes over and over again. But there is one thing that we have learned from these type of industries, because there are multiple, and that's the failure mode effect analysis. It's also part of Lean. It's basically looking at risk from a different perspective by just asking yourself the question, how can this go wrong? And what we do is basically, in the Netherlands, ignore that. Because in a lot of countries, it's intensively being used, but we don't use it in the Netherlands that much. And that means that at a certain point, we have a hard time understanding how problems can arise. So let's now combine the two industries, flying and IT, and let's talk about the 737 MAX. Boeing is a commercial company, just as Airbus is. And they wanted to be better, to be able to compete better, and especially with the new series, the Neo series, that are a little bit bigger. So what they did, they took their number one plane, the 737, and made it bigger. Because of that, and because of some infrastructure with the plane, they had to place the engines on a little bit different place. And because of that, the aerodynamics of the plane changed a little bit. It had a nasty habit of sometimes doing this. And basically, if you do this with a plane, you crash. And that disrupts the flow of your day. So what they did, they fixed it in software. Because if aerodynamics can do it, let's try it with software instead. And they built a system called MCAS, or MCAS. And basically, what that system would do is push the nose down. As soon as it detected it went into stall. And how do you detect it went into stall? Because of all the equipment you have in the plane and the signals you get into your computer systems. So if the computer says nose down, it will go nose down. And now, as a special feature, we will not tell the pilots. And why would you tell the pilots? Because, exactly, as soon as you have to tell the pilot, you have to train that there is a system. And you have to train them, that means it's a different plane than the planes they are used to and certified for flying. So if you need to get new certification, you're not competing with Airbus anymore, because you can get in a lot of Airbuses with a certain certification and fly different models. So the software will fix this issue. Now, what happens if your computer gets the wrong reading with the MCAS system? It will push your nose down. And the pilot will not understand why. And it happens to be the case that, especially during takeoff, there are several situations where exactly this will happen. And why is takeoff important? Because the time you have to figure out what the fuck is happening with your plane is a little bit shorter. And also that, of course, hinders the... Also that hinders the flow... No. The flow of your day. As a result of this, of course, there are questions are being raised. How is it possible that certain regulators missed this? Especially the American regulators. Well, because they don't know jack shit about software. They know about aerodynamics, they know about planes, how you those type of things, but not about software quality. And if you were to look at software quality, what would you find? What's the uniform standard to build high-quality software? Exactly, there isn't. We don't have it. So we deliver stuff to an industry that has a total set of different rules, and we say like, oh, don't worry about it. It's software. You can trust us. It will be okay. And of course, the European regulators started to distrust the American regulators. And it's a very interesting conflict right now. But hey, for me not to worry, because I wasn't on the 737 MAX. I was on a Dreamliner. A Dreamliner is also a very interesting plane. It had a very interesting bug recently. It turns out that if you don't reboot the computer systems often enough, at certain points, your entire systems might just hang up and you have to reboot the entire system, no matter if you're on the ground or in mid-flight. Now, if it's a software industry, how would we deal with vulnerabilities? Let's say we'll take an American security researcher who lives in Amsterdam, like Chris Kubeka, and she finds a bunch of vulnerabilities. Well, the first thing Boeing did, sue her, start to threaten, start to, you know, make her life miserable at least. And of course, when things go public, you go shout things like, we sincerely appreciate the time and effort that went into Ms. Kubeka's research, and we take the concern she raised seriously as we continually work to enhance the cybersecurity of our IT systems and products. As DHS itself has recognized, none of the issues Ms. Kubeka identified are unique to aviation. Do I need to finish or... What happened in the mindset is that they moved from being aviation to being a software company and see the results accordingly. There's a second security researcher who found some issues with the entertainment systems because some of the source code of the 737 MAX and I believe the 787, but don't shoot me if I'm mistaken on that one. He found them on an unprotected FTP server. And he made some remarks about it, especially since the entertainment system was hooked up to the airplane using a UTP cable. But of course, that couldn't be abused at all. And recently we found out that also the rockets we sent into space, when made by Boeing, have sometimes a bunch of vulnerabilities that are really breaking the flow of your day. So this is all the more recent part, right? Wrong. For the Dutch among us, remember this crash? Remember the news that was recently there? that it turned out that there was a second part of the report that has not been made public, where apparently the data flowing into the computers was at least, and let me be very careful to say so, but at least had some influence on the proceedings of that day when this plane crashed. We write software basically based on the expectation that everything works perfectly. And in reality, software always fails. Back to my trip to Tenerife. No, that's not me, that's my wife. She was at least having a good time. So what you don't know doesn't hurt you. In her case, maybe that was indeed for the better, because there's little you can do as soon as you have taken off. And I decided, for the sake of my marriage, not to share the worries I had and not to spoil our holiday. But looking back at all the things and the readings, and there is something definitely wrong in our industry, and we are really lacking the standards and the quality in software to really be able to deliver software to these type of industries. I could have picked the healthcare as well. I could have picked so many other industries. But really what we do is we don't have any set of basic standards that deliver a high quality, and say with the lack of that, we still want to enforce our rules on their industries. And maybe we today can make a change by saying maybe we should stop doing that. Because what you don't know can actually hurt you. We should really start to work a little bit more risk-based. And time again, we see that if we, especially in the security industry, we like to do that, go secret, things are going to get in control and we will get hurt. Later this year, or actually later this month, I'll start a podcast together with BNR News Radio, and I'll say this in Dutch because it will be in Dutch. It's called the Onderzoeksraad der Dingen, where the only issue will be how does software fail. So again, my cats. Hero is my chief information officer. Below there is Brani. She's my chief information security officer. And Keiko is my data protection officer. Because again, if we keep putting people in important positions with lack of knowledge, I think my cats do a better job. So having said that, I would like to open up the floor for a couple of questions, but these are the points that I really, really wanted to share with you, and I really hope that you will make different, help make different decisions, because we are in a position that we can do the right thing or point towards the right thing, at least. Any questions? Did I offend anybody? Oh, Mendel.
Should we stop using JavaScript now? Should we stop using JavaScript now?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wat vind je van alle overheid en DNB ondergebracht bij Centric, waar één persoon de dienst uitmaakt volgens een aandelenconstructie?
Raising the question, but let's take it away from Centric alone. But let's take. How can we get to a position that this is possible? You know, with a lot of other industries, this would have been totally unthinkable. And now it is basically we have to move on with these type of companies for the basic reason that we just can't move away like that. It's a nightmare, but it's one of those not a signatures that there's something totally awry in our industry where we at least should start to make a difference. And it shouldn't be about Centric or another company, but indeed if something happens with quality that is unacceptable, you should be able to move easily away. So you need to talk about who owns software, what open source, open standards, those type of things to have at least some safeguards for the bad day and at least to be able to move away. Now it's still possible that we have a supplier that makes backup mistakes and you can't update the software you're using. And at that point, when you have like a very expensive machine, you have to make the decision. And I had an incident a couple of months ago where this exactly was the case, where you have to make a choice. Do I use a crappy machine or do I throw away millions of euros? So yeah, this is a very fundamental question.
Do you think that everybody should be able to write software or that it should be a licensed profession?
It could very well be that everybody is able to write software as long as you've got standards and you can throw away software and, you know, we really do our due diligence. But as soon as you raise the question, for instance, with the Kaspersky case, one of the questions I raised is, if you don't distrust them, why don't you check the software? And then you go like, yeah, that's too much work. Yeah, because our industry is not, you know, making an effort to do so. And we're not training the people to do all the due diligence. That's not the issue of the company in question. That's the issue of us as society failing. And then you get a lot of people in the security industry, especially in a city close to the sea, with a lot of politicians in it, where they say, you know, but if you start to check software, you might still miss things, so there's no point in doing so. This is really what they say. That is where the real issue is, in my opinion.
What's in the water there?
What's in the water there? Yeah, good question.
Well, very much still a question that I think is a very relatable one to this one is, do you think that actually the politicians in this whole scheme of, for example, having like singled out companies that are responsible for a lot of software within our municipalities, do you think that those municipalities or those customers of those software actually should speak up as a whole towards like suppliers in order to change the behavior that they actually currently are doing right
yes,
now.
I do think so, but I don't think it will happen because in the Netherlands we've had multiple investigations where basically the conclusion is that the politicians don't know anything about the IT industry and they don't care. So if it will happen, it will come from Europe. It will not come from The Hague. So that's an issue. And you know, with all the bullshit with cyber and all these marketing terms that we keep using, you know, we shy away from the real discussions that are really important, or the general remarks, like recently somebody saying during a lecture, yeah, you know, it's an arms race and we'll never be able to win because it's an arms race. Well, Misha, you and I are a lot at incidents together. Hardly ever do we find a root cause that is, and with Mike as well, that is really unique. It's always, you know, old software, the whole thing, all the things that I mentioned, those are the things that we find all the time. The only thing that is a rat race is the exploitation of those weaknesses. So let's stop saying it's a rat race because it isn't. It's not having the basics in place. It's basic hygiene for the most of it. And yes, there will be arrest risk there where we can say that might be a rat race, but at this point in time, I hardly ever see that.
Yeah. In this case, do we need much more entertainment-based things like Citrix and NotPetya and things like that?
And that, yeah, absolutely.
To resolve this with politicians, or do we need to be more activistic and send them, yeah, I don't know, mail bombs or other information campaigns?
No, I don't think mail bombs will do it, but the way we are activistic and, you know, pointing out and making it look ridiculous is, I think, very important because it's one of the steps, but also, of course, grow up. And if I may give another example, in Europe we now are getting the Cybersecurity Act. I haven't read anything in the media. It's a big change coming up. But in the Netherlands we are going like, no, we've got our own standards, we've got our own world. In May, the healthcare industry will have safe email. They've got a whole standard for it. I'm happy with the basis, but the thing is, this is Europe, this is the Netherlands, and then we pick one industry and there we are going to fix a problem. What's wrong with this picture? That needs to change.
So you called a few industries that are doing not the good things, and you that all have things to improve. Is there a gold standard where we should achieve to reach that? What industry is doing the good things?
Well, actually, if you look at shipping or you look at the aviation industry in general, they hit the right movements, and in a lot of things the standards were high. But as soon as software gets involved, we tend to forget that. So, in transportation, we see a lot of good examples. And I'm not against, every risk. The only thing is that we are failing so big because we are trying to push our marketing way of looking at things on the rest of the world. And that just doesn't work. So that is really the issue.
Last question.
I read also something about Boeing, Boeing took over McDonnell Douglas, but in fact the management from Boeing was taken over by the management of McDonnell Douglas, and they went from a safety and technical driven company to a financial and commercial driven company. And that's what often happens and leads to problems and even disaster.
When things get corporate, they get sometimes corrupted, yeah. That's definitely what I see as well. It's not that I'm against Boeing, I just notice that it is very visible there at the moment. I don't know where we will be in 5 years' time. Maybe Boeing might be a leading example of a company making a change. For now, the only thing that I just observe is as soon as software gets involved, things fuck up, and we don't, and we don't train the people to do the right thing. By the way, where Air Europa ultimately decided to leave, because otherwise they had to cancel the flight. It's a business economic decision. And on a positive note, beer.